I'm very excited to be here tonight and share with you some of the research that I've been doing for the past few years. I've spent my time mapping the internet and analyzing all devices that are connected to the internet. I've been trying to learn as much as I can on my own about the internet itself and what is on it, and released the results of this data as a search engine called Shodan. My search engine is most widely known as a security tool nowadays, but that's actually not what it started out with. It started out as an academic exercise for me to use new and cool technology. You know, I wish I could say I had an amazing foresight, I was a genius, I knew that all this data would be useful for security, but I didn't. I didn't know how it would be used. I just did it for fun. Because Napster, about 12 years ago, came out with this peer-to-peer technology, which was very revolutionary back then. It let you share information with other people without needing a server. So I wrote a version that would let you crowdsource analyzing the entire internet. Because it was very slow, the internet's very big, it takes a lot of resources to look at everything, unless you're Google. So I created a tool like that. And I didn't think about security. I thought that information would be used by businesses to figure out who is using their product, how is it configured. Like Cisco could know, oh, these countries are using my product, these people are patching their systems, and the same information could be obtained about their competitors. So I thought about business intelligence. And I also expected that when I released the search engine, that people would find the same things you'd find on Google. You'd find the Facebooks, you'd find the YouTube, you'd find all these things that you use every day. Subconsciously or unaware that I was biased. My view of the internet was actually incorrect. I forgot that when I use Google, when I use all these services, I am seeing the internet as they are presenting it to me. I'm getting a filtered view of the internet by using these services. As soon as I released it, people started finding all these different devices that I didn't really expect to be on the internet. You know, a big one was webcams initially. You know, people started searching for things they're familiar with. And they found webcams. Even today, webcams are the most popular search on Shodan. But then they started discovering new things, and more weird and twisted and kind of funny things. For example, this is a smart egg carton. So it will keep track of how many eggs you have in a carton. This exists, this is a real thing. So if you're at work and you're like, oh, how many eggs do I need? Just pull up your iPhone and it'll tell you. This was a bit unusual. And over time, people started finding more serious things. They started finding things like the Google office in Australia. They started finding, you know, traffic lights and car washes. And they even found power plants, nuclear power plants. I mean, big, big things were discovered on the internet, and wind farms as well, and all these things that you don't traditionally associate with being on the internet. Now, if you go to Google and you type in nuclear power plant, you're not going to actually find a nuclear power plant. But with Shodan, you kind of do. And this should give you an idea of how the project has grown over the past few years. So I mentioned early on it was difficult to look at the whole internet by yourself. Well, within the past 5 years, we've really changed. And nowadays, I can look at the whole internet within a few hours. It's gotten much faster, much easier, much more accessible to track every device on the internet, essentially in real time. In terms of raw numbers, I keep track of more than 500 million devices on the internet. And I try to break it down this way by saying that the World Wide Web, meaning Google, Reddit, Twitter, everything you use on a daily basis, is powered by about 50 million devices. So 50 million power everything you use. You know, sometimes behind these devices you have bigger data centers and whatnot, but on the internet, only 50 million devices. That's not that many if you think about it. And the other 500,000, what are they? So that is what I spend most of my time analyzing. And this is how I feel about the general landscape of the internet, and especially how people perceive it. You know, everybody looks at the surface. That's what everybody interacts with on a daily basis. That's what they're familiar with. There were Googles and everything like that. But in terms of actual size on the internet itself, that's the minority. That is not the bulk of the devices on the internet. And when I start talking to people about, oh, there are power plants online, you know, first they're a bit surprised and then they're confused. this seems weird. Why would anybody put this on the internet? Right? What's the reasoning behind it? So it's been a very slow process. For the past 10 years or so, businesses have decided that they want to save money by putting these systems on the internet so their technicians can remotely manage their factories. If you're a company in Norway and you acquire a factory in Taiwan, you still want to be able to access all the data in real time from anywhere in the world. This is an important business requirement nowadays. And obviously, you save a huge amount of money in doing so. Nowadays, you can even install iPad applications that'll help you manage a water treatment facility and help you manage all these things. And the same benefits that apply to businesses also apply to individuals. This is a Lockitron. It was a Kickstarter project. And it effectively turned your front door lock into an internet-accessible front door lock. So you could unlock your front door over the iPhone. You know, you're at work and your friend shows up, and how do you let him in? Well, no problem. You just unlock the front door over your iPhone. I mean, there are real benefits to having these things in your lives. The general premise is always, it'll improve your quality of life, it'll save you money, it'll save energy, it'll be a huge benefit. And we're moving to a world where there's only going to be more tracking, there's only going to be more of these types of devices. Recently, Apple announced HomeKit. And as part of it, they also announced what they call iBeacons. These are devices that, as a business, you can put around your store, and it'll tell you where your customers are spending time. So if you're walking around a shopping mall, you're in a store, the business will know where you're spending your time on. So they can optimize the floor plan, they can optimize where they're putting different items. They will be able to keep track of your movement and feed that into their business process to, you know, save money, make more money. This is really valuable information to them, and they're very interested in deploying this everywhere. So essentially, we're moving to a world where everything is starting to become digitized. Everything is starting to be collected and analyzed, you know, big data. Everybody wants to store everything. We're already starting to see some iPhone applications that let you keep track of every aspect of your life. You know, how many calories do you burn each day? How often do you go for a run? You know, how often do you brush your teeth? All these aspects of your life you can keep track of. And again, the premise is that you'll live a healthier, happier life. To a large degree, you can already do that nowadays if you want to talk to machines. For example, at any moment in time, I can tell you which printers across the world need to have their toner replaced. This is publicly accessible information. You can keep track of this. And because I do it so quickly on the internet, I can tell you how fast do they respond to, you know, toner replacement. This is all easily accessible information nowadays. And printers are not super interesting, but this also applies to the wind farms I mentioned earlier. I can tell you which countries are producing how much wind energy, which countries are deploying more wind farms, how big are the deployments. All this information is publicly accessible, and it's really cool data. You don't need to guesstimate anymore. You don't need to, you know, figure out through other ways. You can talk to the machines directly. You can ask the wind farm, hey, how many turbines do you have? How much power do you produce? There's no guessing anymore. You have exact numbers, and you can keep track of it over time. But there are some downsides. So there's an amazing future, and it'll definitely happen. But we need to be aware that as we start connecting these devices, we are adding computers. They have the same problems that your desktop has. This was a case where they discovered that a refrigerator was used to send spam. I know most people don't think of a refrigerator as being a computer, like your Windows operating system, but they are. And they faced exact same issues with viruses that a desktop does. And they are different, though, because with Windows and your regular desktop, it takes care of patching for you nowadays. You know, we went through a rough patch, you know, 10 years ago where you have viruses every day, but they figured it out. And nowadays, you have security built in. But if you buy a light bulb, you know, that you can control and change the color on your iPhone with, it doesn't automatically patch itself. And you're going to have it in your house at least for a few years. So you're installing all these devices. They don't have security built in. So what happens to them? And when I talk to people about, you know, light bulbs or egg cartons and all these things, they're like, you know, give me a break, John. Well, what's the big deal, right? You know, somebody can turn off my light. I don't really care. You know, I'll survive. I'll manage. Even if my refrigerator blue screens, it's, you know, rebooted or something. But there is a real problem with this. I should warn you. Because these devices are used everywhere. You know, everybody uses light bulbs, everybody has refrigerators, everybody buys TVs. So just in security world, there's this concept of criticality by numbers. That if you have a huge amount of something, even a tiny issue becomes very dangerous. You know, what if I can connect to all light bulbs in Norway and turn them off at the same time? Or the refrigeration units in summer. You can turn a trivial problem in a refrigerator into a national security problem. Because they're connected to the internet, you can act on them at the same time. It's very easy to do. So I really want to hammer home the whole point that these devices are becoming smart. You need to stop thinking of refrigerators or light bulbs or the world around you as being these dumb objects that don't know anything about you. They're starting to keep track of you. You know, they're mostly listening right now, but they store data on you. They keep track of your habits. And very often, they share that information with their company or other devices in your house. Again, under the pretense or advantage of making your life easier. So if you go into your home, you know, the coffee machine will automatically brew a new fresh cup for you. It'll start the sound system. It'll adjust the AC to the temperature you want. It'll do all these things automatically for you, which is really cool. But you need to keep in mind that for it to do that, it has to keep track of your behavior. It has to keep track of what you're doing. And unlike, you know, Windows or even smartphones, these devices don't have permissions. They don't have privacy policies built in. You know, if you visit a regular website, it'll warn you, say, hey, you know, we have cookies, we collect this information on you. So it's very transparent. Again, we've gotten better at this over the years. These devices don't have that yet. It's very much the Wild West. Everything goes. So I really want to hammer home the point that there are two main things I'd like you to take away from the talk. First of all, that the internet is not just Google. It's not just Facebook. It's not just Twitter or YouTube. It's not the World Wide Web. It's much, much more than that. And it's changing every day. We're seeing more of these devices come online, more of these smart devices being deployed every day. So the internet is very different from what you use on a daily basis. Even though you will continue to interact with Google and Twitter and everything like that, the actual internet itself is shifting. And more importantly, as you start seeing these devices, you know, in the grocery stores or shopping malls, as you start seeing these smart technologies, think about the privacy aspect. Think about the security. The person that sells you these devices, you should ask them, how are you protecting my privacy? How are you storing this information on my behavior? What are you doing with it? What will happen when my refrigerator gets hacked? How will you respond to this? You need to demand from the companies that they built security in by default. We already have it in Windows, we already have it in other areas, and we need to be proactive about this. Because there's a real danger that if we don't start looking at the problem early, it could develop into a bigger issue down the road. At that point, thank you.